Hey everybody, Ryan back again here on Father Fish for the Natural Aquarium. And today we're going to actually get into those details that I alluded to the last time. And that would be things involving light, temperature, water, and even food to emulate different seasons to help encourage your fish to breed or to just bring a more natural element to your natural aquarium. And if you need to see that video, I will link it right in the details and you can head back and watch that first if you need to. Otherwise, let's go ahead and dive right in. Har, har, har.
In the wild, freshwater ecosystems change with the seasons. Temperature rises and falls, water chemistry shifts, food sources appear and disappear, and daylight hours will fluctuate. These natural rhythms affect fish behavior, plant growth, breeding cycles, and even water clarity. Now, most aquariums tend to run on a stable, unchanging setup. If you're keeping species from areas that have pronounced seasons, you might want to actually enhance their health and behavior by gently mimicking those little natural shifts in seasons. So what can we do? Well, we're going to go over several things, first of which is the light duration. The second will be temperature changes. The third will be water changes, and the fourth will be things having to do with food. I'm going to save you a little time and you won't have to take any notes this time, but you know, you might need them for the test. Okay, just kidding. But I am going to link a document for you guys down below, and this document will have everything that I'm going over, so don't feel like you have to take notes as we go, but you can always go back and look at segments if you want to hear me explain them. Okay, so it's very simple to explain relationship here, and it's that during summer, typically areas that are not immediately next to the equator will have longer hours of light during the summer and also more intense light during the summer than they do during their winter months, in which they will receive less hours of light and less intensity. So what makes the equator so special? Well, being that it receives roughly the same number of hours of light per day, no matter what time of the year, and also the intensity does not change much, it's rather unique. And some of you may logically conclude that, hey, would the seasonal thing even work for fish that are near the equator? And the answer might be yes, depending on the fish, because during these seasons that they do have, there is a wet season and there is a dry season. And due to the wet season having massive amounts of cloud cover, some of these places can even have less hours of sunlight penetrating the cloud layer than other areas. So when it comes to doing these things, you're going to want to do your homework. Figure out, what does this fish's natural environment look like? Is it one that is further from the equator? Then yes, it might need to have more or less hours of daylight in the summer or the winter, depending on what happens there. And so how are we going to do this? Let's start with the wet season. So the wet season, that would be the summer months, and the summer months should have longer hours of light. So in some places that might end up looking like 12 or 14 hours, depending on what latitude these fish normally reside at. And as we transition off of our wet season, we are going to reduce the photoperiod very gradually from that 12 to 14 to maybe somewhere around 10 to 12. And then as we hit the dry season, we'll be at our lowest number of hours of light per day, somewhere around 9 to 10 perhaps. And after this, we can transition back to the wet season again and very gradually raise the number of hours per light back up to our 10 to maybe 12 hours per day, and then eventually hit the wet season once more. Everything that we just went over for light pretty much applies to temperature as well. Our wet seasons are generally the warmer months, and so we would have our temperature up at its highest, somewhere between maybe 78 and 84 degrees Fahrenheit, depending on, of course, your fish's natural environment and regular temperature range. After this, we will let the temperature fall by just a few degrees until we get to our dry season, at which our temperature will be at least 2 to 3 degrees lower than our wet season temperatures. And this is where the bit of caution comes in, folks. Please research your fish's normal range of temperature and make sure that you are not going to be exceeding that normal range for very long, because it will stress them out. Let's talk water. So, during the dry season, there won't be as much water entering the system. So what does this mean for us in our aquariums? What we can do is we can let natural evaporation take place. You can let the water level of your tank go lower than you would normally have it. If you're a person who likes to have it topped up all the time, maybe you let it drop just an inch or two, or maybe a few inches if you're comfortable with it. And the cool thing about this is that we are still following the no water change philosophy here, and we're just letting evaporation do its thing. Now, when it comes time to start ramping back up to the wet season, this is where you can start to add in some water very gradually to combat what had been lost by evaporation. As far as what water you're going to use, I prefer to have some rainwater. Sometimes I will end up using some distilled water or some RO water, but I always make sure that I am remineralizing these waters, because if they were at a base of zero or next to zero parts per million, you might end up changing the water chemistry too much depending on how much you let evaporate. And again, gradual change is what we're seeking here. We're not seeking to dump in more than the lost 2 gallons overnight. That is not how a natural transition would go, and it would probably shock your fish a little bit. In fact, everything that I have listed in my chart and the subsequent page that comes after it in explanations is all a very conservative thing, because in the end, I don't want you to hurt your fish, and you probably don't want to hurt your fish. So hopefully we can agree that small change is always going to be for the better. Let's talk food. So naturally, in the rivers and streams that most of our fish are found in, there will be some seasonal changes in what are the available foods. There are some fish that will switch to eating insects or end up switching off eating insects depending on their availability, because insects are going to come out and breed depending on how warm it is, especially as you get higher in latitude. So if there is a high time to feed live foods like our Daphne, our copepods, our worms, whatever it is that you are normally feeding your fish as a live food, you really want to ramp those up during the wet season. This is when the fish are looking for those high proteins so that they can start breeding like crazy. This is also the time where we start to get a lot of things washed into the river due to these rains, and this is when our invertebrate populations are really booming. And you can see this if you've had an outdoor pond. It's currently what I'm going through right now, because the flowers and leaves are falling off the tree and some of them are getting blown in, and all of my little invertebrate life has been eating this and then also eating the algae that has bloomed due to the increased number of hours of sunlight per day. So as we come off of the wet season and we start to transition to the dry, this is of course where you will start to cut back on the feeding, you'll start to cut back on the amount of leaves and stuff that you're adding into your aquarium, until you hit that dry season in which we will just let every leaf and everything in there kind of do its decomposition, and we're going to be at our lowest amount of feeding. And then as we start to transition back to the wet season in the springtime, of course we will start to add all of those live foods back in. We'll start to ramp up just a little bit, and maybe a few leaves can start to be added to the tank to get us ready for the wet season once more. Now let's talk about the rest of your tank. It's not just about the fish that are experiencing all these changes. Even the plants can go through changes, especially plants like bulb plants. They have those nice little bulbs at the bottom that are storing a whole bunch of energy for the plant, because oftentimes they will go through seasonal change of losing their leaves, and then they will be dormant for a while, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, you've got leaves again. These phases will also cause there to be some melt of your plants, and this is something that you may want to monitor, because there are some species that will tolerate it better than others. But the melt can be a good thing, because it will be nutrients returning to the tank to be used again when it starts to grow once more. And one of the other cool things that you can start to see is that some plants that are normally greener in lower amounts of light could become pink or red when it becomes more intense. And another special bonus is that you may even see some flowering out of plants that you have not seen flower before. This ultimately could lead to a concept that we know in environmental science known as succession. And ultimately, if you have one plant that really loves that warm season and you put in a colder, drier season, well, it could leave an opportunity for a slower growing plant that can tolerate that different condition to then sprout up and take over. And that lovely fast grower will have to wait until it is the wet season again to sprout back up. So all of these instructions can be found on the sheet linked below in the description, or maybe I'll pin a comment, we'll see what happens here. And really, again, the biggest thing here is that it's a bit of an experiment. You will find that there will be some changes that you did not expect, and the best way that you can track those is to keep some form of log or journal. That way you can see, like, hey, where was I before? Where am I going? Maybe take a before picture and take another snapshot every week. Also, this is something that you don't necessarily need to do, but it is something that I would encourage if you have a tank that is more mature and you have been struggling to breed a particular type of fish. So it turns out, despite wanting to wrap out on this particular episode of seasons and breeding, I actually have more to teach you. And it's mostly going to be revolving around finding out what your fish's natural habitat looks like. And then also we're going to specifically take a look at a few different fish as some four examples and how you could actually apply this to your aquarium. So if you find that you are going to want a little bit more before you dip your toes, join us on the next episode.
And there we have it. You're more seasoned on seasons. And if you'd like to join us on this journey, please jump into the Father Fish Discord. Leave us some comments down below. Hey, what are things you've tried before that have worked? And don't forget to hit that lovely little like and that subscribe wherever that button is. Maybe I'll put one there. I don't know. I get lazy sometimes. And then join us again here on Father Fish for another episode of The Natural Aquarium coming soon. Thank you.